Hey, what up, y'all? Knowledge of Raven 2468. YouTube, Snapchat, Instagram, Twitter, Rizzle, all of them. All of the platforms that y'all see me on. Man, I got an unsigned message for y'all today. This is about the wearing out of the saints. And it's a lot of scripture that backs all of this up. So the very thing that you're hearing, I want you to go back and study it for yourself, because it's going to be a lot of information, but it's on time to what we're dealing with right now. So first of all, we always begin by praying. As y'all can see, I'm outside. I had to come out here and get in the sun and dwell in it, man. You know, staying in the house all the time ain't enough for me. I like to get outside. So Father, we just come to you today, thanking you for your viewers and for your people, Father God, for those that are listening to this message, this on time message, Father God, that you dropped in my spirit and my sister's spirit as well, Father God, because without you, none of this will be possible, Father God. So we just ask that you allow the Holy Spirit to come in right now and dwell in us, that the word that comes forth be from you, Father God, and an on-time message. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Hey, nephew. So, first of all, y'all know the message. It said, new levels, new devils. You are tempted the most when you are at your lowest. When you at your lowest point, man, is when the enemy started working on you. Y'all know that to be true, because when we go and look into when Jesus was in the wilderness, when he was fasting for 40 days and 40 nights, the enemy came at him at his lowest point and asked him to do things. Let me turn that down, sorry. Basically, enemy came to him and tempted him in many ways than none, but he stayed strong. He stayed steadfast in what he was doing, steadfast in his faith, stronger than his faith. Why? Because Jesus is God of the earth, which was God. And how you know that is when you dive into scripture, when Jesus talked to his disciples and the people, and they wouldn't allow him to come into the synagogue, which is the church. He told them, I am the Father, and the Father is in me. So, when you look at Isaiah 59, look at it. Look at the rabbits. Look at them. You see them?
This is your dog.
I don't want it.
Okay, he's going to sit down by you.
But I'm not going to go straight into Isaiah 59 right now. What I'm going to do is I'm going to go read the Father's Heart Ministry. That's where a lot of our stuff that we've been reading in just these on-time messages, because the Father's Heart Ministry is, it be on time every morning. So I'm going to get there. Hold on 1 second. My nephew's going to keep on bugging. Yes. Yeah, nephew, but I'm doing a video right now.
I tried to get him.
Okay. You ain't going to be able to catch them. That's nice. That one right there, it ain't going to be the way that you want to. It's a mosquito. Step on it. I don't know. Just step on it. That way you know that it's dead. So step on it. So it's dead. Don't be scared of it. Okay, so the Father's Heart Ministry says this. The Father says today, there is no chart for what I am doing in your life. And this season, you can't put slide rule to what I'm bringing out, bringing about as though I move according to the logic or rationale of man. Relinquish the demand for understanding. Tell your mind to shut up and sit down, and tell your spirit to rise up and take charge. As Joshua met the angel of my presence before the fall of Jericho, so I have sent my angel to you and my presence before you to bring down the work of the enemy and put you over in an astonishing and remarkable way. Those around you who are egocentric and bound by their reason and intellect will scratch their head and not understand. Let go of every tendency to justify my purpose to mind-bound thinking, for I am doing more than you can ever ask or think. I am making myself known to you in dreams and visions, so pay attention. I am bringing knowledge to you in the night seasons and wisdom to you in the day. I am putting you in the cleft of the rock, and I am showing you my glory. You will shine with the glory, and you will outray the divine. For I am manifesting myself to you, bringing you into face-to-face relationship to me. Man cannot arbitrate this connection between us, for I did not die to relate to you to a religious institution or the ideas of men who think they have the right to stand between you and my throne. That is the lie. That is man lording over my heritage. And I will expose them for the anemic and insipid influence that they represent. I am bringing you into direct contact with my person that you might be a full-on participator in all that the cross and Calvary paid for on your behalf. This is your time. This is the moment that changes everything, you and everything around you, to your benefit, says the Father. Man, stay the course. Stay the course, y'all. You understand. You have to look at your life as the chosen one, as one that's chosen. That's why you still here. Because we still got time to get it right, man. People going to come against you just the same way that they came against our brother King Jesus. But I want to tell y'all, that's when you tested the most. That's when your faith is tested the most. Just like when Peter was in the boat and he asked the Lord, he said, Lord, if it be you, bid me come to you. And what happened? He came to him. He walking on water. He wasn't focused on nothing but focused on Jesus. And as soon as that storm came, it frightened him. And it tested his faith. And because it frightened him, he began to sink. He began to sink. And the Lord is like, you know, just think about it like this. Like, man, if you don't get up, how long, man? Like, you can do the same thing that I'm doing too. But how strong is your faith? Where's your focus, Peter? Is your focus on me? Is your focus on the storm? Is your focus, relate that to your life right now, is your focus on what you're going through, or is your focus still on the Creator? Because you know that these things are going to come. You know that the storms are going to come because it tells you that these storms are coming. For our disobedience, for not focusing, not listening to our instructions. So what happened? We began to sink. But we gotta rise up as Peter did, rose up and put his focus back on God. So we gotta rise up and put our focus back on the Creator. Put our focus on him daily, not just, you know, on Sunday. That ain't enough. You gotta do this daily. You gotta spend time in the Word daily, all day, every day, at night before you go to bed. With your children, pray over them. Pray for them, pray for yourself, pray for other people. And keep on doing this daily, man. Because your lives, as you know it, has begun to change. And we're gonna go into Isaiah 59 right now. Cause I got a treat for y'all. And it says this, and I'm going to read from the New King James Version, if that's all right with y'all, because I read from a lot of versions. And the preface of it says, separated from God. Behold, the Lord's hand is not shortened, that it cannot save, nor hear, nor his ear heavy, that it cannot hear. So the Lord's hand is not short to where it can't grab you. The Lord's hand ain't no T-Rex arms. His ears, he ain't deaf. He can hear you just fine. He done heard your cries. He done heard your prayers. But your iniquities have separated you from God. Your iniquities, your sin, have separated you from God, because just like Judas, the very thing that he did, his sins condemned him so much. They came after him in many ways. They was pulling him down like he can't be forgiven, like he must not be forgiven. But Jesus had already told him, he already told him that he knew that he was going to do it. Do what you got to do, Judas. And he was then forgiven, but Judas took into his own hands because he knew what he had done was wrong. But that's still prophecy. The wrong that you have done, you don't need to condemn yourself or kill yourself, man. You just need to kill the old you, not in the physical, but in the spiritual. Kill the old you and walk in a new way. Walk in your forgiveness. Walk in what God has given us all, grace. Grace through faith. And it says, and your sins have hidden his face from you so that he will not hear. For your hands are defiled with blood. Wait a minute. Let's go back. So your hands are defiled with blood. Who else's hands were defiled with blood? King David. Cain, when he killed Abel, was defiled with blood. And your fingers with iniquity. Your hands of sinful nature. Your hands have killed someone. Your hands have done some things that they weren't supposed to do. They weren't created to do, but we did them anyway. Your lips have spoken lies. Your mouth has spoken lies. Has spoken lies about you. Spoken lies about others. Called people names. Cursed people. Did the very thing that we're not supposed to be doing. Your tongue has muttered perversity. Your tongue has said a lot of things that it shouldn't have been saying. Has tried to say it under, or not tried, did say it under your breath, but you thought that nobody heard you. But the very one who created you knew what you said. No one calls for justice, nor does any plead for truth. They trust in empty words and speak lies. They conceive evil and bring forth iniquity. They hatch viper's eggs and weave the spider's web. I want y'all to remember that part where it says viper's eggs. They hatch viper's eggs and weave the spider's web. We hatch our children that do the very same thing that we do. And they get caught up in a web. Like a spider's web. How? When a fly flies into a spider's web, it's caught. It can't get out. Our kids are caught up in a web. Our children, some of us still caught up in a web. He who eats of their eggs and dies, and from that which is crushed, a viper breaks out. Their webs will not become garments, nor will they cover themselves with their works. Their works are works of iniquity, and the act of violence is in their hands. The act of violence is in the hands of our very children, of even the ones that were before our children. The violence have been in us because we want to take revenge, or we want to do things because we want to be like everybody else. We want to hold the gun. We want to be blasting up the set. You know, we want to be putting, just doing everything that we ain't supposed to be doing. We want to be sleeping with other people's wives, other people, kids and husbands and things like that. Kids want to do what the grown folks do. Grown folks want to do what the kids do. Wrong is right and right is wrong. Blasphemous. Their feet run to evil, and they make haste to shed innocent blood. Their thoughts are thoughts of iniquity. Wasting and destruction are their paths. The way of peace they have not known, and there is no justice in their ways. They have made themselves crooked paths. Whoever takes that way shall not know peace. You won't know no peace, man. You take those crooked ways. You take those, the ways that the enemy have given you, you know, at the lowest point. The things that you know you ain't supposed to do. You ain't gonna have no peace. You keep on chasing after men, you ain't gonna have no peace. You keep on chasing after women, you ain't gonna have no peace. You keep on chasing after money, you ain't gonna have no peace. Not at all. Still gonna be of ruin. Sins confess. Therefore, justice is far from us, nor does righteousness overtake us. We look for light, but there is darkness. For brightness, but we walk in blackness and darkness. But it said blackness in the New King James Version. We grope for the wall like the blind. We be feeling around, you know, walking down pathways like we blind, like we can't see nothing. You know how you walk in your house or in somebody else's house and it be dark, and because you can't see, you stick your hand out there and you be trying to feel for stuff that you can't see, trying to feel for a wall. And we grope as if we had no eyes. We stumble at noonday at twilight. Right there. We are as dead men in the desolate places. We all growl like bears and moan sadly like doves. We look for justice, but there is none. For salvation, but it is far from us. Just like they did in the wilderness, again, we bring up the wilderness, when they were delivered out of the hands of the enemy, delivered out of Egypt, what did they do? They started moaning and groaning and crying and worshiping false gods and idolatry and doing all the things that they weren't supposed to be doing, that we weren't supposed to do. But they started operating as the heathens did. They started operating as what they saw when they were in the land. Look at us. We in a foreign land, and we starting to operate as the very same ones that did the things back in the day in the wilderness, in the wilderness, but were delivered from the hands of the enemy. But yet and still, they wanted to go back to that because of what they saw, what they heard, what got into their subconscious. They wasn't focused on Moses. As long as Moses was performing miracles for them and doing what the Lord told him to do, then that's when they focused on him. But when the storms came, when they wasn't seeing anything, they focus got off of Moses and they began to sink, just like Peter did in the water. Began to sink in the enemy that you can't see. Started tempting them. Because just as Jesus, what we talked about earlier, Jesus was tempted. And while Jesus was, while he was fasting and praying, he was hungry because he wasn't eating nothing. He was hungry. But he stayed the course. He kept his focus on God and on the word of God. Every day, all day. It didn't matter what the enemy tried to do. He couldn't come against God. He can tempt all he wants to, but where is your focus? Are you going to fall into destruction? Are you going to sink? Or are you going to rise up and tell the enemy that he has no power? And when he comes back again, because he comes back with seven more of them, are you going to keep on telling them the same thing, or are you going to turn your focus away from the enemy, turn your focus away from God and focus on what the enemy is telling you, tempting you to do? For our transgressions are multiplied before you, and our sins testify against us. For our transgressions are with us, and as for our iniquities, we know them. We know our sinful way. We know what we did. We know what we did. Everybody know that they done some wrong. Ain't no point no finger at nobody. Everybody done some wrong. In transgression and lying against the Lord and departing from our God, speaking oppression and revolt, conceiving and uttering from the heart words of falsehood. Justice is turned back and righteousness stands afar off. For truth is fallen in the street and iniquity cannot enter. So truth fails and he who departs from evil makes himself a prey. So when you walk away from evil, when you turn away from the evil, you are now prey. You are now prey to the enemy, because now he wasn't messing with you while you was doing the evil things you were doing. He was, you know, you was enjoying yourself. You was having fun. You were doing everything. Wasn't no destruction coming your way. You just living it up, partying and doing whatever you got to do. All of us. But then when we stop doing those very things, what happened? That's when the enemy's like, okay, I got to go get them. Because now they finna start waking people up. Because they used to do the very same things that I was tempting them to do, but now they didn't stop. So now they starting to wake up. They starting to rise up. They starting to come out of the pit. They starting to get their focus back on the Creator. They starting to understand that I'm really not in control, that I'm just tempting them. And in their temptation, in the tempting ways that I am tempting them, they are now noticing that it's just that, it's just temptation. But I only tempt them when they're at their lowest. I only tempt them when they change their ways. But while they're doing my works, I don't tempt them at all. Because they too far gone. They caught in the spider's web. The Redeemer of Zion. Then the Lord saw it, and it displeased him that there was no justice. He saw that there was no man, and wondered that there was no intercessor. Therefore, his own arm brought salvation for him, and his own righteousness, it sustained him. For he put on righteousness as the breastplate and a helmet of salvation on his head. He put on the garments of vengeance for clothing and was clad with zeal as a cloak. According to their deeds, accordingly, he will repay fury to his adversaries, recompense to his enemies. The coastland he will fully repay. So shall they fear the name of the Lord from the west, and his glory from the rising of the sun. When the enemy comes in like a flood, the Spirit of the Lord will lift up a standard against him. The Redeemer will come to Zion, and to those who turn from transgression in Jacob, says the Lord. As for me, says the Lord, this is my covenant with them, my Spirit who is upon you. My words which I have put in your mouth shall not depart from your mouth, nor from the mouth of your descendants, nor from the mouth of your descendants, says the Lord, from this time and forevermore. Wow. So God told you in the word, told you right there, that I had to come down here myself, dressed in white garment, and I'll go back and read it again. The Lord saw it and displeased him, that there was no justice. He saw that there was no man that could do what I created them to do. Dig with me now, y'all. And wondered that there was no intercessor. Therefore, his own arm brought salvation for him. He came down himself. What did he do? And his own righteousness, it sustained him. For he put on the righteousness as a breastplate. And a helmet of salvation on his head. He put, hey, how you doing? And put on, I'm great. And put on the garments of vengeance for clothing. Come again. I'm doing one right now. And was clad with zeal as a cloak. According to their deeds, accordingly, he will repay fury to his adversaries. God came down here, y'all. In a fleshly form, named Jesus. And that's the only way that that could happen. But he had to be born from flesh in order to walk in the flesh. He had to go through everything that he already knew we was going to go through. He had to come down here and do it all over again for his elect, for his people. And you dig deeper into it, man. And I'm going to go to Ephesians, because this is where it talks about, for we wrestle not against flesh and blood, but against principalities. Let's go there. In Ephesians, if you got your Bibles and you're watching, you're tuning in, please go there. And I want y'all, don't just take my word for it, man. Go and study it for yourselves. Go study it to see what the Lord is telling you. what the Holy Spirit is giving you. Okay, Ephesians 6. And it's like 24 verses. And it says, Children, obey your parents in the Lord, for this is right. Honor your father and your mother, which is the first commandment with promise, that it may be well with you and you may live long on the earth. Obey your mother and your father so you may live long on this earth. And he's not just talking to, the parents before us and the ones. He's talking to everybody. All of us were supposed to listen to our mothers and our fathers. We're supposed to obey them. But y'all know we didn't listen to them all the time. And what happened? We started doing things that we shouldn't have been doing. We started going places that we shouldn't have been going. Some of us got locked up. Some of us got killed in the streets. Some of us joined gangs and started killing our very own people, our very own brothers and sisters. Some of us turned to other ways. Drugs, alcohol, sex, looking for love in all the wrong places. When they told us not to do that. They told us not to go out there and have sex with anybody. But we did it anyway because we were disobedient. And you fathers, do not provoke your children to wrath. He talked to the fathers on this one. Don't be provoking your kids to wrath. How do we provoke our children to wrath? By leaving them, leaving their mothers, putting our hands on their mothers, abusing them mentally, physically, spiritually. And then our kids be left here to fend for themselves. I was one of those kids. Some kids before me was one of them kids. I was disobedient to my mother. I was even disobedient to my father. I was disobedient to everybody. Because all I ever wanted was that, my father. But when you grow up, you then start to operate differently. The very thing that you wanted when you were a kid and you start having kids of your own, you want to do that for them. You should want to do that for them and not leave them and not provoke them to wrath the way that we were provoked to wrath. You should want to stay there no matter what. Even if you and the mother of your children do not work out, it is still up to you as the father of those children, your children, to leave them and not leave them for the mothers to take care of them on their own, because the mothers are some very strong ones. I'm telling you, there's some strong mothers out here that had to endure a lot, that prayed for a lot. But even to the ones that are not the children of the women that you get with, become their father and their leader. Lead the way that you wanted your father to do for you. Don't operate as the heathens do, as they tell you to do. Love on them, man. Love on them. Bring correction to them without even having to put your hands on them or put a belt on them. Because that provokes them to wrath. And then that trains them for when they get older, how to put hands and a belt on their kids or even on their women or the women on the men. Stop doing that. And you fathers, do not provoke your children to wrath, but bring them up in the training and the admonition of the Lord. Bring them up with the training and admonition of the Lord. Bring them up the way the Lord tells you to do it. The way the word tells you to do it. The way Jesus told you to do it. Love your wives as I love the church. Who is the church? You are the church. The very people that go into the synagogue or the church, as some people call it, whatever. There's nothing new under the sun, but you are the church, because when you leave that place, it is just a building. It's just like leaving your house. The place, it's just a building now. It don't become a house until somebody builds it and then people go in there. Now it's a house. It's a covering. It's your domain. But when you're not there, what is it? Just a building. Just an empty place. A quiet place. Bond servants and masters. Bond servants, be obedient to those who are your masters according to the flesh. Now, when it says bond service, it's talking about slaves. Slaves. With fear and trembling and sincerity of heart as to Christ. Not with eye service as men pleasers, but as bond servants of Christ. But as servants of Christ. With honor and with integrity. With love. Doing the will of God from the heart with goodwill, doing service as to the Lord, not to men, knowing that whatever good anyone does, he will receive the same from the Lord, whether he is a slave or free. As you masters do the same things to them, giving up threatening, knowing that your own master also is in heaven, and there is no, what is that? Partiality with him. That means that to the slave masters, God saw what you did. God knows what you did and what you're doing. And you have some structure and order that you're supposed to follow too. But hey, I'm just giving y'all the word and what the word says. This ain't, come on now. The whole armor of God. Finally, my brethren, be strong in the Lord and in the power of his might. Put on the whole armor of God that you may be able to stand against the wiles of the devil. For we do not wrestle against flesh and blood, but against principalities, against powers, against the rulers of the darkness of this age, against spiritual hosts of wickedness in the heavenly places. Everything that you're going, that's coming against you right now. You think that it's your family. You think that it's your friends. You think that it's your job. You think that it's all these things, but those are just mere vessels that's used to tempt you, to anger you, to frustrate you, to shake you up, to get you off the path that God has for you. But again, it's nothing that you can't see. You can't see this with your physical eye. You have to see this from a spiritual standpoint. Study to show yourselves approved. Therefore, take up the whole armor of God that you may be able to withstand the evil day, and having done all to stand. Therefore, stand therefore, having girded your waist with truth, having put on the breastplate of righteousness, and having shod your feet with the preparation of the gospel of peace. Above all, taking the shield of faith with which you will be able to quench all the fiery darts of the wicked one. Everything that he fires at you, pew, 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 it ain't touching you at all. It's not touching your spirit, but it try to hit your flesh. And it try to tell you, oh man, this brother coming against me, this sister coming against me, my mama coming against me, my father coming against me. And I'm talking about everybody. That's how people feel. Because you really think that it's them that's doing it. But it's the spirit that's connected to them that's pushing them to do it. Because they don't know that that spiritual being that's sitting right next to them is the one that's controlling them, that's tempting them. Just as Jesus was tempted in the crowd, or not Jesus, yes, just as Jesus was tempted in the wilderness, just as the crowd was tempted when Jesus was standing in the midst of the crowd. And they began to say things about him that the enemy was telling him, slandering his name, because they began to fear that if they knew him just the same, or they would have said that they knew him, they would have thought they would have got killed too, crucified, knocked off, because they were afraid. And take the helmet of salvation and the sword of the Spirit, which is the word of truth of God. Praying always with all prayer and supplication in the Spirit, being watchful to this end with all perseverance and supplication for all the saints. And for me, the utterance may be given to me that I may open my mouth boldly to make known the mystery of the gospel, for which I am an ambassador in chains, that in it I may speak boldly as I ought to speak boldly. A gracious greeting. But that you also may know my affairs and how I am doing. I don't know how to say the brother's name, but I'm going to say it. I'm going to try to pronounce it. Tychius a beloved brother and faithful minister in the Lord, will make all things known to you, whom I have sent to you for this very purpose, that you may know our affairs and that he may comfort your hearts. Peace to the brethren and love with faith from God the Father and Lord Jesus Christ. Grace be with all those who love our Lord Jesus Christ in sincerity. Amen. Man, and that's just it, y'all. Just stay diligently seeking him, man. Resist the enemy and he shall flee. Resist the darkness and let your light shine. We're going to talk about the cockatrice. Some of y'all don't know what a cockatrice is, but I'm going to give it to you. And that's in Isaiah 59, about the cockatrice. And we're reading from the King James Version. And it's in verse 5, Isaiah 59, verse 5. They hatch cockatrice eggs and weave their spider's web. He that eateth of their eggs dieth, and that which is crushed breaketh out into a viper. Remember, I told y'all we was gonna go back here. A cockatrice is a rooster and a serpent. It's a mythical creature. It looks like, it has a rooster's face, but it has a serpent's or a dragon's body. And how do you kill it? You have to burn it. How did God slay the world before? Or how did he say that the world would be slain? By fire, right? Abominations. Anything that's not of God has to be what? Burned. Has to be burned. If you're not of God, if you're not following in his commands and in his teaching and obeying his laws, I ain't gonna sugarcoat it for you. But you're gonna burn. But he gives us a way out to turn away from those ways and to operate in a new way so we can then be forgiven and don't go back no more. Don't go back to where he brought you out of. Don't go backwards. Keep on going forward. You know, I see people posting on Facebook about relationships, but they go back to the very relationship that tore them down to try and fix it instead of letting God fix it. And I'm talking about even for myself too. I went backwards plenty of times. Went backwards, did the most heinous and craziest things. But when you know better, you do better. When you know that God brought you out of that situation for a reason, when you know that you're not supposed to be with that person, you won't go back there. No matter what, because you ain't gonna let them destroy you or let the enemy tempt you any longer. You gotta turn away from those ways. Hatch from a cock's egg, two-legged dragon having power to kill by a look. Whoa, wait a minute. A two-legged dragon that's hatched from a rooster's egg. A rooster. So a rooster hatches the egg, then leaves the egg to basically fend for itself. And the serpent comes up. And now it operates as a serpent does. Sneaky. Wow. Wait a minute. Who used to do that? Y'all know that mythical creature that be on them movies? What's her name? Medusa. A mythical creature with snakes in her hair. that turn people to stone, that kill people with what? A look. Be watchful, be mindful, man. That's just like kind of like them things that we talked about last week about sirens. Ain't talking about no sirens on no police car, no ambulance, no fire truck. Nah, I'm talking about them sirens that pull you in. Women, men, they pull you in with a song, pull you in with their looks, bat their eyes. Put on some chains, some nice gold chains. Be sagging. Cause you going by what you see and what you hear. But again, what are you watching? What are you listening? Where's your focus? Who is your focus on? Is your focus on the Creator? Or is it focused on the things that the Creator created? Are you idolizing that brother or that sister? Don't do that no more. Y'all, we in that wilderness. This is part two of the wilderness from yesterday. We in that wilderness. We in the wilderness. In this very moment, we are just like Jesus in the wilderness being tempted to do wrong, to make wrong right and right wrong, which is what? An abomination, blasphemous. We are in that time. Why are they doing this? They're giving it everything. They're giving you devices, giving you money, telling you that it's okay for women to sleep with women, men to sleep with men. It's okay for you to have a side piece, for you to be married and have this many women and this many children on the slick slot. All the while, you can't even take care of home. Because you're too busy trying to take care of other things, but ain't trying to take care of home. You ain't trying to take care of the very kids that you created. Because you over there playing parent to somebody else's child when you got your own children to be parenting. And like I said, even when you get in a relationship, women, men, and the brother got kids or the sister got kids, take care of them just as well as you take care of yours. But allow the Lord to send you the very one that he has for you already. That he ordained for you to be with. Allow for him to be who he said that he is. The creator of it all. And he will provide it all. But wait and keep your focus on him. Stop focusing on everything around you and focus on the Creator. Stop sinking. Stop sinking like Peter. Keep your focus on the Creator. Man, it's so many more messages. Like even in 1 Thessalonians. Like, I'm not trying to be before y'all too long, but it's just dropping in me to give this to y'all. And I want y'all to go and study it. As I'm saying it, write it down, and then go back and study it for yourself. And let's have a conversation about it. Let's have church about it. Outside of the synagogue, or the church as you call it. Because again, you are the church. 1 Thessalonians. Chapter 5. But of the times and the seasons, brethren, ye have no need that I write unto you. For yourselves know perfectly that the day of the Lord so cometh as a thief in the night. We all know that it says that the Lord is going to come like a thief in the night. Don't nobody know the time nor the date. For when they shall say peace and safety, then sudden destruction cometh upon them. As travail upon a woman with child, and they shall not escape. Now, okay, for some of y'all that's reading the King James Version, I know that some people don't really understand it. So that's why I go to other versions. I studied the King James. I just studied a lot of it, okay? I'm not boasting. I'm just telling you, like, there's ways that you can study the word and go back and research it for yourself. Study to show yourselves approved. But again, always ask the Holy Spirit to give you the knowledge, the wisdom, and understanding to know what you're reading and know the difference. So in the New King James Version, it says this, the day of the Lord. But concerning the times and the seasons, brethren, you have no need that I should write to you. God says, I ain't got to write to y'all. It's already there. It's written already. For you yourselves know perfectly the day of the Lord, so comes as a thief in the night. For when they say peace and safety, then sudden destruction comes upon them, as labor pains upon a woman, a pregnant woman. Labor pains. When a woman getting ready to have a baby, she go through so much pain. So much pain. And she just ready to get that thing out of her. Like, she be like, Lord, get this baby out of me. Take this, you know, like, you know. And they shall not escape. But you, brethren, are not in darkness, so that this day should overtake you as a thief. You are all sons of light and sons of the day. We are not of the night nor of darkness. We are the light. Let your light shine. You might be dark-skinned. You might be dark-complected, or as they say, people of color. But let your light shine, because your light does shine. The very ones who hate you and kill you or come against you want to be you. They want to be like the sisters. They want to get the lips, the hips, and everything that the sister already has. The beauty that's within. The brothers. But let your light shine, because you are chosen. You don't gotta operate as they do. Be who you are. Be who God created you to be. And you wasn't created to be somebody's slave. That was a choice. It was a choice of the ones before us, and the ones before that, and the ones before that. It was a choice. And because that was our choice, God granted it, because they wanted to go back. So then they suffered, their children suffered, their children's children suffered, the ones after them suffered, the ones after them suffered for 400 years. The 400 years is up. August 2019, your 400 years was up. We are not of night or darkness. Therefore, let us not sleep as others do, but let us watch and be sober. Be sober. You don't need to drink. You don't need to smoke. Be sober. Be pure. For those who sleep, sleep at night, and those who get drunk are drunk at night. Oh, what happens? They drink at night. They smoke at night. Some of them even do it in the daytime, because they darkness. That darkness, that dark time that they in. Some of them don't want to say that they in a dark time. Oh, I just want to have fun. I want to do this. I want to operate as the heathens do. But let us who are of the day be sober, putting on the breastplate of faith and love, and as a helmet, the hope of salvation. For God did not appoint us to wrath, but to obtain salvation through our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ, who died for us, that whether we are awake or sleep, we should live together with him. Therefore, comfort each other and edify one another, just as you also are doing. We're supposed to comfort one another. We're supposed to help one another. We're supposed to love on one another, respect one another. Not kill, steal, and be jealous and destroy one another. That's the enemy. That's the temptation of the enemy. Various exhortations. And we urge you, brethren, to recognize those who labor among you and are over you in the Lord and admonish you, and to esteem them very highly in love for their work's sake. Be at peace among yourselves. Now we exhort you, brethren, warn those who are unruly, comfort the faint-hearted, uphold the weak, be patient with all. See that no one renders evil for evil to anyone. Don't kill your brother because your brother been killed, or kill a brother because your brother been killed. Don't kill a sister because your sister been killed. Don't harm a woman because someone harmed you. Don't hurt nobody because they hurt you. Because you know that saying, hurt people hurt people? That is very true. But heal people, heal people. You don't hear that very much, but that is true. Heal people do heal people that are hurting, that are yearning for something, that are asking for something, a change. But always pursue what is good for both yourselves and for all. Always pursue the good. Always look for the good. Rejoice always. Pray without ceasing. In everything, give thanks, for this is the will of God in Christ Jesus for you. Pray all day, every day. Whenever you want to pray, just begin to pray. Don't let nothing stop you. Just begin to pray and thank God for what he's already doing and what he delivered you from and where he's taking you. Do not quench the spirit. Do not despise prophecies. Test all things. Hold fast what is good. Abstain from every form of evil. Abstain. Be sober. Practice abstinence, celibacy. And I ain't just talking in sexual ways, because yes, that is one. That is a good one right there. But abstain from television. Abstain from drinking alcohol, smoking marijuana, doing all type of drugs. Abstain from it all, from the music that you listen to. And go in a new way. Listen to some good stuff. Watch some good stuff. You can have fun with that too. You don't need to be drunk or high, or you know, be partying at night to have fun, or the music to have fun. The very thing you listen to, you start to become. The very thing you watch, you start to become, because it's in your subconscious. It's back there somewhere, because the enemy is still yet tempting. But you don't know that you're being tempted. You don't know that you're being led astray. Blessing and admonition. Now may the God of peace himself sanctify you completely, and you, and may your whole spirit, soul, and body be preserved blameless at the coming of our Lord Jesus Christ. He who calls you is faithful, who also will do it. Brethren, pray for us. Greet all the brethren with a holy kiss. Not an evil kiss. Because who gave somebody a kiss and turned them over? Judas. But greet all your brethren with a holy kiss. Mwah. A holy kiss. It did say a physical kiss, but a holy kiss. A kiss of love. A kiss of honor. But to your wife, brothers, I'm talking to y'all right now. Give them a kiss. A kiss of love. A kiss of honor. A kiss of forgiveness. A gift or a kiss of healing and not harm. I charge you by the Lord that this epistle be read to all the holy brethren. The grace of our Lord Jesus Christ be with you. Amen. So all in all, man, again, the enemy is trying to wear us out. He's trying to wear out the saints. He's trying to wear out the saints by tempting us in many ways, just as he tempted Jesus Christ. But stand strong in your faith. Stand up and stand anyhow. Rise up, let your light shine. As even on the prayer line in the morning, we say, rise and shine, Jesus is on the main line. Man, y'all feel free to call in, check it out, listen in. We have devotionals, Bible studies, testimonies, praise reports. Some people call in because they're going through some things and they just want prayer and they'll get off. Or some people call in because they want to cry out. And we just love on them and pray for them and stand in the gap for them. That's what we need to do for one another daily. Take time out with God daily. Whether it's by yourself in silence, you know, to spend time in the Word and what the Word is telling you, what God is telling you, the Holy Spirit is giving you. But also, we need to do this with our brothers and our sisters, the church, the very ones that are on the outside, that are crying out. As I say all the time, it's not just your family that's blood related. You have so much more family that's not blood related, but that is related by blood, by the blood of Jesus, by the Creator, because the Creator created all of us. So let's begin to step in a new way of love, the way that Jesus told us to. I love y'all. Blessings to y'all. Knowledge.